Well, good morning, Cornerstone. Happy Friday. Happy Chapel Day. Excited to worship with you guys this morning. You know, it's February, and I'm excited. This is going to be a great month. I'm looking forward to Spirit Week. That's going to be just an amazing time. Well, guys, I've got some 8th grade shout-outs for us this morning. These are going to Mrs. Finney's 8th grade class. So, good morning, guys. I want to say good morning to Tony, Chloe, Jared, Eli, Maddie, Melinda, Danny, Keith, Elena, Matthew, Addie, Bryce, and Karis. Good morning, guys. We love you. We're thankful for you and so excited that you guys are here at Cornerstone. Thank you so much for being a part of our community here. Well, guys, here is our call to worship this morning. And this is coming from Psalm chapter 25, where we'll be on, where we will be in a little bit later. But here's our verse for us this morning, verses 8 through 10, as our call to worship. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble in his ways. All of the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. Guys, this is our call to worship this morning. We worship because of all that Jesus is, all that Jesus has done, and now, as a response, we're going to go ahead and give our praise to him. So go ahead, stand up, and let's sing in response to Jesus.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. My fear doesn't stand a
me seek your kingdom first. As Jesus walked, so shall I walk, held by your same unchanging love. Be still, my soul. Oh, lift your voice and pray, Father, not my will, but yours be done. How in that garden he persisted, I may never fully know the fearful weight of truth.
Well, good morning, Cornerstone. You know, this entire month leading up to Spirit Week, we're looking at our relationship with Jesus. We've talked about growing with Jesus through difficulties, abiding with Jesus where he's the vine and we're the branches. And today we're going to be looking at the topic of prayer. But before we dive in, I want you to turn to a friend or a neighbor and tell them your favorite superhero. If that's too hard, tell them maybe one of the many superheroes that you really like. Guys, I love superheroes, and I have a lot of favorites, but if we're going Marvel, then hands down, I have to say Spider-Man. Call it a Parker thing. But if we're talking DC, then hands down, I have to go with Batman. Guys, how many of you are Batman fans? I love Batman. Batman is so cool. I love his story about being a tortured hero, struggling to live in the present as he tries to make sense of his past. All the while, he's seeking justice in a broken world. I love that. Now, some of you might argue that Batman isn't a real superhero. And if this is you, please invite me to your homeroom for lunch and we can discuss this at length. But arguably, guys, one of Batman's greatest strengths is his tool belt. That's right. Let's look inside Batman's tool belt just to see some of the things he has in there. He has a retractable grappling hook. He has batarangs, bat cuffs, chemical gas pellets, a Batmobile wireless remote control, a crime scene recorder, digital micro camera, and wireless communication with Alfred and the Batcave computer network. With all of those awesome tools, Batman is absolutely, guys, he's the Dark Knight of superheroes. Now, some of you might be asking, Mr. Parker, what does Batman have to do with prayer? And I'm glad you asked. Because Batman, he needs his tools in order to accomplish his mission. As Christ followers, so do we. We need tools that will help us understand who God is and who we are as his children and how to live out our true purpose as Jesus' ambassadors in this world. And one of those tools is prayer. Now, throughout history, guys, there have been so many books written about prayer by people who are like way smarter than I am. But today, I just want to focus on one key verse from the Psalms, which is arguably the best place to learn how to pray. So, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Psalm chapter 25, and we have one verse today that we're just going to be looking at. One verse, Psalm 25, verse 14. Let me read it for you this morning. It says this. It's a Psalm of David, and in verse 14, he says, "The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him." The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him. Let's go ahead and pray this morning. Ask God to speak to us. God, this is your word, and we're humble to sit under it this morning. Thank you that we can open it, we can study it, we can learn and grow, but none of that happens, God, apart from your Holy Spirit taking the word that is sharper than any two-edged sword and making it come alive in our hearts. And so I now pray for your Holy Spirit to move in our midst this morning. Break us, Father, of all the patterns that keep us away from you. Take us deep in our relationship with you. And God, grow us in prayer. We want to learn how to pray in a more full, more deeper way. Lord Jesus, would you get me out of the way, but would you use your word, the one true word, and speak to us for the glory of your name. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our relationship with God is one of friendship, and that's what we see in our verse here. You know, the Psalms teach us how friendship with God is grown and cultivated. One of our questions in SFGs last week was that you could sum up all of Jesus' teaching in John chapter 15 with one simple question. Is Jesus your best friend? If you want to take a second and pause the video and just talk about some of the qualities that make a good friend, you could do that. But you know, a good friend is someone who you can trust. They love you and stick with you in the good times and even in the bad. They won't gossip about you. A good friend is someone who you can talk to. They're a good listener. They'll give good advice. A good friend is someone who sees the best in you, but also who isn't afraid to call you out when you're doing something dumb. A good friend will laugh with you, cry with you, eat with you, go on vacations with you, but most of all, here, guys, a good friend, they're with you. And I think that's what makes our verse from King David so important. You know, think about the life that King David lived. You know, we could describe him as a connected man. He was a man after God's own heart, Scripture says, but he was broken. He was filled with the same heart that you and I have, one that seeks our own good instead of God's. But David knew that he couldn't hide anything from God, and the result for David was a white-hot prayer life that brought the good, the bad, and even the ugly into God's presence through prayer in order for God's heart to be grown and cultivated in his own. Through prayer, David would express his love for the Lord, his frustration with others. He would confess his sin in Psalm 51. He would plead for his life, repent, but most of all, he would remember the God that was with him through all of that and was doing something bigger and better than he could immediately see in front of him. Let's all say this today. God's got a bigger and better plan. Ready? 1, 2, 3. God's got a bigger and better plan. It's true. It was true for King David. It's true for you and I. King David isn't the only one in Scripture, though, who understood the importance of friendship with God. You know, in Exodus 33, verse 11, Scripture says that God talked with Moses as a man talks with a friend. In James 2:23, it says that Abraham was a friend of God. And John, the disciple of Jesus, in 1 John, it says that the same intimacy that they shared with Jesus when he was here on earth, it's possible and available to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Guys, let's say that today. It's possible, it's available. 1, 2, 3. It's possible, it's available. Guys, praise God. May it be so here today. You know, friendship with God is possible and available because God himself is in the perfect friendship relationship with himself, the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They're one, yet in perfect unity and friendship with one another. That intimate friendship is so central to God's identity, and it's the same for you and me. We're made in God's image. We're made for that intimate friendship relationship with the living God. And through prayer, as Jesus followers, we take hold of this relationship. We pour into it. We invest in it and grow in relational friendship with the living God. But guys, I've been in ministry for a long time. And as someone who has just struggled with prayer personally, I know that when we talk about the possibility and availability of friendship with God through prayer, this can be difficult. And if you've ever felt like, man, Mr. Parker, I am just not a good prayer, guess what? You're in good company. The disciples of Jesus, they themselves felt the exact same way. And they watched Jesus cultivate intimacy with God through prayer. And they asked him one day, they said, Jesus, teach us to pray. Guys, have you ever been around someone who just seemed to be in touch with God through prayer? Maybe you came away from that experience saying the same thing. I want to pray like that. Well, you're in good company because guess what? No one here on earth starts out a prayer expert. We all learn how to pray from the scriptures, from other people in our lives, and even Jesus himself as we take the same steps that Jesus took to cultivate a praying life. Guys, just right now in the quietness of our chapel, just in the presence of God, if you want to grow in your prayer life, I just invite you now to say a prayer quietly in your heart, not out loud, but just to say, Jesus, teach me to pray. Guys, if you want to grow in your prayer life, if you want to grow in your friendship with Jesus, and you want it to go deeper today, I invite you now to just say that prayer, Jesus, teach me to pray. Let's pause and you can just say that right now. Guys, I said that prayer right along with you. Well, for the remainder of our time together, I just want to give you 4 ways that we can cultivate friendship with God through prayer. 4 ways we can cultivate friendship with God through prayer. Here's the first. Obey. Maybe that might not be where you thought I was going to go, but this has to be the first step. You know, when Joni and I were engaged to be married, we went through premarital counseling, which, guys, that is just a must before you get married. And at the time, we had a really great couple who was pouring into us and talking to us about all the things that made marriage great and all the things that made marriage really difficult. And one of those activities that we had to do in our counseling sessions was read a book called The 5 Love Languages. Maybe some of you have read it. I bet a lot of you have. In the book, they explain that each person gives and receives love in different ways. For me, my love language is affirmation, words of affirmation. Encourage me with your words. And then my second was physical touch. I want to hold hands with my wife in public. That's how I receive love. But my wife's were different. Her main love language is quality time. Spend time with her, talking, doing fun activities. But her second is acts of service. That means do chores. Now, the interesting thing about the love languages is that often people tend to give love the same way they want to receive love. And this was a huge learning curve for both of us because we had different love languages. As a words of affirmation guy, I would say things like, I love you, babe. And being an acts of service girl, she would say very kindly, if you love me, do the dishes. Now, if you know my wife, you know she's amazingly sweet, and I don't ever remember her saying it just like that. But we had to learn very quickly how to speak each other's love languages in order to show our love for one another. You know, God has a love language, and it's this, obedience. You know, in last week's passage, just a verse later, in John 15:14, it says this. Jesus says, you are my friends if you do what I command you. Here we go. Friendship with God is cultivated as we walk in obedience with him. Friendship with God is cultivated as we walk in obedience with him. This is God's love language. But our obedience to God, it's always a response to his love for us when we simply didn't deserve it. But we don't obey out of compulsion or try to earn friendship with God. Guys, we know we can't do that, right? With sin in our hearts, it's impossible to please God. But that's what makes the gospel so sweet, right? Jesus said in one verse earlier, he said, greater love has no one than this, than someone who lays down his life for his friends. God's response to our sin was the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ laying down his life, suffering and dying in your place so that you could be his friend. We obey because deep down inside, we've personally experienced the goodness of the gospel when we didn't deserve it. Guys, also early on in our marriage, Joni and I had to learn the importance of asking really good questions. And one of those questions that we would ask each other is, hey, you know what, honey, is there anything that I do that annoys or frustrates you? Now, guys, warning, this is a dangerous question. And I would say things, you know, I'd think like, you know what, I honestly can't think of anything. You're so nice and servant-hearted. And then it was my turn. And I knew I was in trouble when she took out a list. I'm just kidding. My wife never had a list. But that is a very important question because friendship isn't going to grow when our thoughts and actions and words are frustrating the other person. Open communication, seasoned with lots of love, mercy, and grace and forgiveness, goes a long way in having these kinds of discussions with husband and wife or just even your friends. We can be vulnerable and talk about our faults and failures with our friends or with the Lord because we know that we are being met by love. This is what's so great about our relationship with the Lord. You know, here's a great spiritual formation question for us. Asking God the question, God, what are the things that I'm doing right now that annoy or frustrate you? Guys, we don't have to be afraid of asking the Lord this question because as he reveals our sin, our cracks, and our faults, he meets us with love and forgiveness. This is a great way to grow your prayer life and friendship with the Lord. You know, friends rub off on one another. Has anyone ever told you that? Or maybe you've even noticed that in your own life. We become like the people we surround ourselves with, the good and the bad. And when it comes to our friendship with the Lord, Jesus has done his part. He has done everything needed to make friendship with him possible and available. But it comes through obedience. You know, Psalm 66 verse 18 gives us this warning. It says, if we cherish sin in our hearts, the Lord will not listen to our prayers. It's only through obedience that we become like Jesus as we spend time with him. Are you obeying? Okay, well, here's point number two. We cultivate friendship with God through prayer, when we're resting in our identity in him. You know, there's a lie in our world that says, we know who we are because of the things that we do. For instance, I know a lot of us have many different interests and passions. But there's this temptation to allow those interests and passions, those things that we do, to define who we are. You know, I shared with you guys a few weeks ago that I grew up in the Michael Jordan era, watching him play basketball. And guys, there's a reason that he is called the GOAT. But watching him in retirement is honestly, it's been heartbreaking because as you listen to him talk, you get the sense that he doesn't know who he is apart from the game of basketball. You know, life has a way of teaching us this lesson. Jobs, guys, they're going to come and they're going to go. Interests will fade. Our bodies will eventually one day break down and we won't be able to do those same activities that gave us life. Someday, you won't be able to paint or speak or play music or maybe even play basketball. And for this reason, we need to know who we are outside of the game or the things that we do, because one day the game or the activity, it's going to let you down, or your body will let you down. Identity is like this on purpose, because the Bible teaches us that identity, who we are, could never come from something that we do. Identity is always received, never achieved. I'm going to repeat that. Identity is always received, never achieved. Ephesians chapter 2 says that salvation is by grace alone. It's a free gift, not by works, so that we could boast. In life, guys, we're going to have lots of different interests, desires, and passions. And if we let those things define who we are, then we'll only be disappointed. But here's the glory of the gospel. God gives an identity that you couldn't earn or do or even deserve, but one that Jesus purchased for you through his life, death, and resurrection. And like we said last week, our hearts will constantly be restless until they find their rest in Jesus Christ. When we apply this truth to friendship with the Lord, it's the difference of thinking of God as our boss or our friend. You know, we obey a boss because we're getting paid. It's our job. The relationship is based on work. You know, work hard and long and you will earn approval. But God isn't our boss. You see, he's our heavenly Father. We obey him because we know that even if we strike out swinging, God is our heavenly Father. And when he looks at us, he is proud of us, not because of what we've done, but because of who we are. And that approval and identity, it came at such a high cost, the death of his son. But as we rest in his grace through Jesus Christ, that propels us to keep swinging, to keep seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. Jesus did all of the work necessary to secure our identity as his children. He fulfilled the law perfectly in our place. So now, because of his sacrifice, we can actually delight in the law and by his strength walk and live it out because Jesus lived it out perfectly for us. That's your true identity. Are you resting in it? Third, the third aspect of growing with friendship with God through prayer is dynamic two-way communication. Dynamic two-way communication. You know, my dad always told me the story growing up when he was a child. He got his favorite Christmas present ever was a set of walkie-talkies. If you've ever had a pair, you know how much fun they can be. And if you don't, guys, if you don't know what a walkie-talkie is, I feel very old. But my dad was so excited to get his set of walkie-talkies because he gave one to his best friend who lived across the street. And each night they would take turns on their walkie-talkies talking to each other. Best friends need two-way communication. If we're going to cultivate friendship with God through prayer, we need to speak, but we also need to listen. God speaks to us in many ways, but God will never say anything to you that isn't in the Bible. You will never hear God tell you, you know, I think you should go gossip about that person in your class on social media. He's never going to say that. But if you want to know that your friend, the Lord, is speaking to you, you have to go to the Bible. Hebrews 4, chapter 4, verse 12 says that the word's alive. It's active, sharper than any two-edged sword. God's words are powerful. And when God speaks, it's his power coming into your life. You know, prayer works like this. God initiates with us through the scriptures, and then we respond to God through prayer. When we pray this way, we're communicating with the God who actually exists, not the one we want him to be. Fourth, this is our last point. We need to experience from time to time his manifest presence. In the Old Testament, they called this seeking the face of God. Face-to-face communication is so much better than Zoom. Would you guys agree? And we know that because of the Holy Spirit, God is always with us. There's not ever a moment in life that he's absent. But there will be times throughout your life when the reality of his presence with you will be tangible. Oftentimes, it's going to take us by surprise. When we come face-to-face with who the Lord is and who we are and all that he's done to make us his friend, there will be sometimes when you're just undone. Maybe it's when you're reading scripture. Or maybe when there's a lyric of a song in chapel, it just hits you like a brick and suddenly you're aware that you're on holy ground. You see, it's one thing to know that God is holy in our mind. It's another thing to sense that he's holy in our heart through prayer or musical worship. So that as we sit with him in his presence in prayer, he starts to change our heart And he gives us new desires. So we don't want to sin anymore. We want to live for him. How can we seek his face? Well, there are just two simple ways. There are more, but I'll just give you two. First, by encountering God in the scriptures. We need a daily, steady diet of reading the Bible, immersing ourselves in God's story of redemption, reading and studying the scriptures to seek his face. It looks like this. We read a passage and then we ask ourselves this question. If I really believe this truth that I'm reading about, how would my life be different? Now, if this is true about God, then what needs to go in my life? And then number two, you participate and sing in chapel. I know it's difficult. We're in classrooms. We're wearing masks. We're surrounded by other people. But guys, worship isn't about us. It's about God. We don't sing because we like singing. We sing as a response to who God is and what he has done through his son, Jesus Christ. Guys, there will be times when you will experience the closeness of God and his mercy and love and grace in your life, and it will be better than anything that you could imagine. This is his manifest presence. And my encouragement is that when and if that happens, sit there, weep, rejoice, celebrate, worship. And then, as he sends you out of that moment, he's not far away. He's with you, carrying you along, moment by moment, day by day, by the power of the Holy Spirit that never leaves you. Well, the ultimate act of friendship was Jesus, the friend to sinners. And he came to live and die in our place so that we could be his friend. As we sit with these truths and practice them through prayer, may the Lord take us deeper and change us from the inside out so that we can confidently say, I am a friend of God. May it be so in your life. May it be so in my life. Let's pray. Lord, thank you that you made a way when it seemed there was no way for sinful, broken image bearers to be restored back to you. Through Jesus Christ, Lord, we see the ultimate act of friendship. We see you laying down your life for people who didn't deserve it. God, I pray for our students here at Cornerstone. I thank you for them. I thank you for their hunger for you. God, for anyone who does not know you, Lord, I pray that they would see that there is a friend in Jesus Christ who sticks closer than a brother. And I pray that you would soften their hearts, Lord, that they would see the great high cost that you paid to purchase a friendship for them, a friendship that would never leave them. I pray they'd respond in faith. God, would you do a miracle work by your Spirit? Draw longing hearts to Jesus. Cause us to turn away from sin and trust in you day by day. And would you take us deeper in prayer? Just like the disciples, God, we just ask that question. Jesus, teach us to pray. We pray you'd receive glory in these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Love you guys. Have an awesome Friday.